Dr. Ganley, let's talk surgery now. You said that you have been working on less invasive approaches here. Tell me a little bit about some of those.
Yes, our interests are in endoscopic laser surgery and also in robotic surgery. So firstly, endoscopic laser surgery is really a technique which is used for cancers of the larynx, the voice box, and cancers at the back of the tongue. The technique involved here is using special scopes which can go through the mouth.
These are flexible fiber optic?
No, these are rigid scopes.
Oh, they're rigid scopes.
So the patients are under general anesthetic. They're small rigid scopes which go in through the mouth, through which we can then visualize the vocal cords of the larynx under high magnification with a microscope. And then attached to the microscope is our laser, which produces a pinpoint laser beam. And using that, we can then really precisely cut out a patient's cancer. And the advantage of this, of course, is there's no skin incisions on the patient's neck or on their face. The second advantage is that it's really what I would call personalized surgery or tailored surgery, because the surgery you're doing is specific to that patient's cancer. And you're able to preserve a lot of normal tissue that using old-fashioned techniques, which were the open surgical techniques, you would have had to sacrifice. So as a consequence of that, you preserve a lot of normal tissue, and these patients therefore have very good function with regards to their voice and also with regards to swallowing. They do not require feeding tubes afterwards. They do not require tracheostomies. A tracheostomy is where you make a hole in the airway to protect the patient's airway after an operation. So these patients don't require that. Very often these patients can have that type of surgery done as a day case procedure. It's a much shorter operation than an open operation. And of course, it's much less expensive than an open operation.
And just to be clear, this is not at the expense of control of the cancer?
No. The outcomes are identical to open surgery and also identical to other forms of treatment, such as radiation treatment.
I think you're probably the one to talk about also some of the sinus surgery and using scopes there?
Yes, so cancer of the sinus is an extremely rare type of cancer. There's up to 20 different types of cancers which can arise in the sinus. And these cancers often will present with a fairly advanced stage. And this is because their symptoms are very
non-specific,
so it's sinusitis or nasal congestion or bleeding from the nose. Many symptoms that people will have and really not think too much about. So traditionally, these cancers required open surgical operations. And this involved incisions on the face as well as incisions on the head. So these operations were done in conjunction with our neurosurgical colleagues. And to this day, I have to say that the open surgical approach is still seen as the gold standard approach for treating these types of cancers. More recently, in the last 10 years, endoscopic techniques have developed. These are very small telescopes. We've got the introduction of fine grasping forceps, lasers.
And this is all done through the nose?
Yes, all done through the nose. The use of new technology with regards to imaging techniques, high-powered drills and saws, all of which are very small in size and can go through the nose. So with these new instruments and with all the new technology, it's now possible to remove some of these cancers through the nose. But I hasten to say that these techniques are really reserved for very select cases, small cancers, and I would say less, the more less aggressive types of cancers are the ones that we would treat by the endoscopic approach.
Dr. Shaw, I know you do a lot with thyroid cancers. Tell me a little bit about that. Is it still a large incision here in the
It used to be, so I think, you know, before even I get into the thyroid, both the approaches Ian mentioned are after a very stringent criteria of selectivity. It is not that you can across the board do everything with the laser or everything through the nose. Keeping in mind that cure of the disease is the first goal, and that should not be compromised by taking the easy way out. It is not the easy way out. You have to be highly selective in what is suitable to be approached by a minimally invasive procedure. So same thing can be applied to thyroid surgery also. Go back 20 years and we would be taking large incisions in the lower part of the neck, creating a new line which the patient doesn't have. That's pretty much history. Modern day thyroid surgery, you should not be able to identify the incision sitting at that distance whether you had thyroid surgery. The incisions are much smaller, many times less than an inch and a half, and always in a natural skin crease, such that you will never find the incision sitting across the table. So things have changed. We have become more sensitive to the needs and expectations of patients in terms of their appearance, in terms of their cosmesis, and in terms of their own personally reported outcomes of satisfaction following treatment, whether it is surgery, radiation, or a combination of both or all three modalities of treatment.
Because as Dr. Ganley mentioned, for some people, such as myself, preserving my voice would be an important thing, so it depends on the individual sometimes too as to what the right approach would be.
Absolutely, and it's I think that's a very important determinant of selection of treatment. And as Dr. Shah mentioned, I mean, that is the key to select the right treatment for the right situation. So just because I am an expert in minimally invasive endoscopic surgery does not mean that, you know, the next person that walks into the door gets that treatment. It has to be the right treatment for that person. And that actually is the most challenging aspect of surgery, to do the right thing for the right person at the right time. And in fact, that's been one of the main interests of our research, treatment selection. So how can you predict outcomes based on what you know at the time the patient walks into the door? So we've developed tools that we call nomograms. These are like computer algorithms where you plug in data that's relevant to that one person sitting in front of you and try and predict what is the risk of the cancer coming back, for instance, what is the probability that that person will do well with surgery versus other forms of treatment. So all those kinds of things are a very active area of our research. And that's, I think, the most difficult part of treating a person. The surgical aspect is relatively easier if you're trained to do how to do things.
Those computer algorithms are one thing, but there's really still no substitute for the experience of the surgeon.
No, not a question. But what I'm getting at is, if you're a layperson and if you do not have the experience that your surgeon or your physician has, it's easier to understand certain aspects of risk prediction if you had some decision aid. And that's what we found useful in clinical practice. It counseled people who are not necessarily used to understanding complex data.
Dr. Ganley, you mentioned robotic surgery before. Tell me what a robot brings to the table here, if you will, when it comes to the head and neck surgery?
Yes, robotic surgery has largely been used in other parts of the body, mainly abdominal surgery and pelvic surgery, so as to involve the large incisions which are made on people's abdomens. And the head and neck, it's really been developed in the last 5 years. The reason it was developed was to try and remove cancers which were inaccessible without carrying out what we call a mandibulotomy. Mandibulotomy means a jaw split. So in order to operate on a cancer at the back of the throat, it's where you can't really see it with the naked eye or feel it with your hands. Traditionally, we would do what we call a jaw split operation, basically opening the jaw so that we can then visualize the cancer and then remove the cancer that way. And that was the traditional way of doing that. But with the introduction of these new robotic or laser techniques, we can now visualize these cancers using special 3D cameras. And these cameras are attached to a robot. And the robot has two arms, which are just like your own arms, a left hand and a right hand. And each arm of the robot will move just in the exact same way that your left and your right hand would move.
So, but the robot's not doing it all by himself.
No.
The surgeon is controlling the robot.
Exactly, exactly. When the patient is positioned in the operating room, the mouth is opened, and then these small arms, they're only 5 millimeters in size, just like small 5 millimeter rods. They are then inserted in through the mouth, and the camera goes in the midline of the mouth. And then the surgeon is about 6 feet or 10 feet away from the patient, sitting in a console. And he sits in the console and looks down into the console, and he will see a three-dimensional picture of the inside of the patient's mouth and throat. It's almost as if you're actually inside the patient's mouth. And then using hand motions are then transferred to the motion of the arms of the robot. So if I move my hand to the left, then the robot's hand will move to the left. Now, these robot hands can have the same instruments that you would use for surgery. So you'll have a pair of grasping forceps to grasp tissue in your left hand. And then in your right hand, you would have an instrument for cutting, such as an electrocautery device.
So the advantage is that you're doing some of the same things you can do with your hand, but in a much
more confined space.
Tighter, smaller space where you're not going to be able to put your hands down someone's throat.
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
So that's the advantage there.